When you go to build a bridge, you don't build it in the open sea. But these men did. When you go to build a bridge, you don't ship it piece by piece over 6,000 miles of water. But these men did. And when you go to build a bridge, you don't expect to fight fog and wind, storm and tides on the same day. But these men did.
In 33, out there in the open sea, many said it couldn't be done, that the battle with the channel just couldn't be won.
Build yourself a golden span, bridge building man.
In 1930, in the midst of a Great Depression, a $35 million bond issue was presented to voters in six Bay Area counties to finance the building of a bridge across the Golden Gate. And the battle was on. Some said the bridge should not be built. Their reasons? The bridge would destroy the beauty of the harbor. One earthquake would topple any bridge. San Francisco would be overrun by picnickers from Marin County. The bridge was called a wildcat scheme. A giant fraud, a promotion stunt. Then on November the 4th, 1930, the people decided. 2 years later, in January 1933, the construction began. It was the biggest single span ever attempted and the hardest place in the world to build a bridge. The bridge design, Joseph B. Strauss, the brilliant engineering conception of a bridge building genius. This was to be Strauss's 401st bridge, and his last. 3,000 miles away in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, at the plants of Bethlehem Steel, the pieces of the bridge were being formed. The tower sections lay ready for shipment to California. The bases for the towers were completely assembled, just to make sure that everything fit perfectly. Then all the sections were taken apart again, loaded on railway cars, and shipped to Philadelphia, where they were loaded onto freighters for the voyage through the Panama Canal to San Francisco. The first job, concrete piers to hold the towers. Walter Cathy was the supervisor.
We had few problems with the pier for the north tower, which we built on the base of a Marin cliff. But the south pier was a different story. We had to build the equivalent of a 10-story building underwater in conditions that sometimes seemed impossible. We had storms and tides and currents and wind all the time. First, we had to build an access trestle 1,100 feet out from shore to the pier site. A fog-bound ship ran through the trestle, tore out 300 feet from the middle and weakened the whole structure. So after we rebuilt this trestle, a storm then carried away 800 feet of it. And all the critics of the bridge project yelled that we would never get the pier built out there. But finally, we got the trestle up to stay. We perfected a system of bombing the ocean floor without drilling. We loaded a bomb into this shaft, and then we dropped the shaft down into the serpentine rock on the ocean floor and blasted for excavation. Finally, we started pouring the concrete to form the fender inside of which the pier would be constructed. So we poured the concrete down a long tube called a treme. Soon the fender was above water, and finally the south pier was completed.
Charles Bender was supervisor of Bethlehem's receiving yard in Alameda.
These steamers come into the dock at Alameda, at which we had two stiff leg derricks for unloading. And from there, they were passed from the steamer onto flat cars, and when they were ready for the job site back down, they were reloaded onto barges. And these pieces were loaded in sequence in the manner that they were needed for their proper place in the structure.
To make sure that the steel tower would start up true and plumb, the pier was polished and leveled to within a fraction of an inch.
Broke the barge, held on tight, got the steel to the old bridge site, saw the tower take off the wraps, pull itself up by its own bootstraps. Go build yourself a golden span.
Marin Tower began with the assembly of the tower base. The steel sections were fitted into the anchorage angles, which extended 53 feet into the heart of the pier. This huge derrick rode up the tower, hoisting steel as it went. This plunger held the derrick in place. When the new tower section was in position, the derrick was hoisted up onto the new section to start all over again. As this operation was repeated, the tower slowly rose above the waters of the Golden Gate. The riveting crews followed 200 feet below the raising gangs, but the tower sections fit together so tightly that even during Pacific gales, they were able to stand without rivets. The white-hot rivets were shot through pneumatic tubes from the heater to the riveters. A 500,000 rivets for each tower leg.
Punch the rivet, don't go slow, got a 500,000 more to go. Push the tower up to the sky, turn steel to glory before the eye.
Getting from one place to another on the half-completed tower was difficult at best. Harold Shermer, the North Tower resident engineer, remembers it well.
I had an opportunity to ride with the superintendent on the first upward trip of the elevator, and much to my surprise, the elevator turned on its side, and we were sitting on the screened cage with the superintendent screaming wildly at the engine men to stop.
If the bridge men, wearing helmets with miners' lamps on them, did manage to get around, they sometimes got lost. Supervisor Cathy had the answer.
Well, those towers are so huge, and there are so many cells in them, that we had to have plans for each man to carry with him. Otherwise, he would get lost in the maze of compartments that are in each tower.
During earthquakes, the tower swayed so badly that the men working on them became violently seasick.
One day we had an earthquake on top of the tower, and a lot of the fellows up there were sick. One Saturday, they had a bunch of people come up there and visit, and there was one feller, he got really so scared, it took two of us to hold him down. He wanted to jump overboard, and then they stopped that right there. No more visitors to the tower.
The last piece for the North Tower, a massive saddle to hold the cables, was hoisted through the fog and put into place. Herman Kurtz recalls working in the fog.
While they had fog conditions, the top of the tower may be in completely out of the fog. Actually, it seemed as though they were floating in the sky.
With the cable saddle in place, the South Tower was begun. Thank you. To begin the cable operation, a small cable was dragged across the gate from one tower to the other. The Coast Guard cleared the way for the barge carrying this, the first cable strand. This is the only recording made of that historic trip.
All clear. Go ahead. And you, Marin Tower, are you clear? Can the barge start across now?
Hello, South Tower. We're all set here.
Are you ready, barge? Ready here. All clear. Go ahead, barge. Okay, we're coming across. We're riding fair, reeling out fast. Current's pretty heavy today, so we're heading up a bit. Here comes the halfway connection. Now we're all clear to the South Tower side.
The supporting cables, one by one, were laid across the channel and then hoisted separately to the tower tops. Finally, with the strands in place, construction of a footbridge began. Materials for the footbridge were carried into position on a work carriage, which rode on the cable strands. When the work carriage got stuck, Clyde Hepworth and a buddy swam the cable.
Hope Sanderson and I volunteered. And we got a 2x6, 36 inches long, nailed a cleat on each side, and set it on two of the cables and slid out to clear up the cable. And they were going to bring us back, but they got us scared when we got out there. And we had to walk those cables. We walked from one cage to the other. That made Muggs and I the first two that ever crossed the Golden Gate.
Mechanical spiders, spinning carriages shuttled from anchorage to anchorage, weaving 80,000 miles of steel into the cable. This had been the toughest spinning job the experienced Roebling cablemen had ever encountered. The cables were spun and placed in record time. At the pier site, the suspension cables were unloaded. The future roadway would hang from these slender strands. With the spinning operation completed, the individual wires were grouped and compacted into the huge single cable. Steel hoops held the strands together as the compacting hammers moved along. Huge castings were next bolted at intervals onto the main cable. Cables were then hung over them and dropped down. Then an outer skin of wire was spun around the cable as a sheath against the weather. During the cable operation, thousands of tons of steel for the bridge floor were arriving. The first three panels of roadway were planked over to provide storage space for the floor beams as they were lifted from the barges below.
Walking on air, climbing up high, working to build our road in the sky. Men and steel in silhouette, a building to spend the greatest yet. Rivets and cords, braces and beams, hanging in space or so it seems. Steel arms reach to meet halfway across the channel of the Golden Bay.
Men built this bridge. Men fighting the weather. Men fighting deadlines. Men fighting fate. Bargemen, raising gangs, riveters, spinners, welders, pavers. Men were building this bridge that couldn't be built. Inspector Getz describes one incident high above the Golden Gate.
One of my duties was to inspect the adjustment of the strands after a strand had been spun and was being set into the saddles and into permanent position at the anchorages. This could only be done at night after everything had cooled down to a uniform temperature, and we would start in about 10:30, 11 o'clock at night, take the elevator to the top of the San Francisco Tower, and then I had to hike across the catwalk to the top of the Marin Tower. Usually it was foggy, windy, and cold, and you would wear rubber rain gear, which was waterproof, but by the time you had climbed up to the catwalk to the top of the Marin Tower, it was like being in a Turkish bath. You were just soaked. You might as well have left the rain gear off. When they were removing the temporary structures at the tops of the tower, we had an incident one night when the watchman who went on duty after dark would walk across this walkway and turn on the lights. So happened that during the day they had dismantled most of the walkway and had left it only one plank wide. And when he walked over there and turned on the lights, he was afraid to walk back again, and he was marooned at the light switch for the rest of the night until the boys came to work in the morning.
On a project of this size and duration, loss of life was expected to be one man per $1 million of work, or a $35 million job roughly equals 35 human lives. Deaths were calculated like so many rivets or tons of steel. Safety measures, however, beyond anything ever seen, had been set up to prevent these deaths. As engineer Shermer puts it,
This was the first lodge structure that I had worked on where hard hats were a must.
But the newest safety device was a huge rope net slung underneath the men wherever they worked. By 1937, the net had caught 19 men, saving their lives. The bridge was nearly finished when a wooden platform holding 12 workmen collapsed above the net. Welder Richard Evans saw it happen.
I was working on the upper side, on the floor, and the platform fell into the net. And one of my friends, we called him Fort Collins because he came from Fort Collins, Colorado, looked up at me as he was falling. His face was pale, and he was grasping out for something to hold on to. And as he faded away, the net folded up, and he was inside, and that was the last I saw of Fort Collins.
Newspaper photographer Joe Deering caught the only still photograph of the tragedy.
Well, I was standing on the foot of a pier. Well, I heard this terribly rumbling up overhead and looked up and saw a net starting to fall, including the bodies of these men, and snapped the one picture which I got.
Elements waited. Everything was against them. Even the concrete froze that March, and everyone knows it never freezes in California. This bridge, different in so many ways from any other, had to have a distinctive color. International orange, they called it. But as Supervisor Kathy points out, not all 60,000 gallons went on the steel.
Well, we had a man, he had quite a little time on his hands. And he'd set snares and catch seagulls. He'd paint the tops of their heads red, and then he'd turn them loose. And one day we looked in the paper, and there was quite an article in there about the new species of seagulls with the red heads. And I guess he'd painted half the seagulls in San Francisco.
And then, almost suddenly, it was done. Captain Rudy Peterson, the man who had surveyed the gate floor in 1929, the man who had worked on most phases of the bridge, was there along with 200,000 others on opening day, May the 27th, 1937.
And me being the first man, practically, that was working on the bridge all the way through from his infancy, for every company that was there, and Stroud, and Savage was the engineer, and so I had my picture taken with Stroud shaking hand. Marin County shakes hands with San Francisco County.
Marin shakes hands with San Francisco. The dream, the wildcat scheme, the cheap promotion stunt, the impossible, had become a magnificent fact.
Back in 1933, a bridge was born in the open sea. A lot of folks said it could be done, but the battle with the channel just wouldn't be won. Build yourself a golden span, bridge building man. Back in both the spinners run, miles and miles of cable we spun. Walked the cable and tempted fate out to conquer the golden gate. Build yourself a golden span, bridge building man.
Big builder, that's me.
And then one day the job was done, the bridge completed and the battle won. With blood and sweat we did create the bridgeman's dream, the golden gate.